Yo, roster breakdowns, they're back. And today we are going to be going over the Arizona Cardinals and the full breakdown and mock draft for the Arizona Cardinals. What is happening? What is going on? My name is GSLING. I'm doing my thing and I hope you are too. And I'm so excited. I love doing these, man. It's so much fun to learn about all the new players and all the situations they had. And you know, that's how you get a good picture too going into the draft and understanding where the needs are and how, you know, or where a team needs to get better. But without further ado, you see it right here, Larry Legend and Kyler Murray for the future. I'm really curious to see. Hopefully Larry Fitzgerald comes back for one more year. I'd love to see it one more year. I think that they're building a team here and possibly a chance to go after a Super Bowl. But let's go ahead and talk about some notable free agent signings and see what they've done so far. These are just some of the moves they've made, some of the big moves. Obviously, the J.J. Watt thing was huge, getting him on a two-year, $28 million deal, $23 million guaranteed. But for a dude of caliber of J.J. Watt, they needed this dude on the interior because, look, I'm telling you, I mean, I like Zach Allen and I like some of these guys they've added with Rashad Lawrence, Levi Fouti, and whatnot, but I don't have confidence in them as more of a starting pieces right now. I'm a little bit worried in that situation. So I love what they did here to add this edge, this interior wrecker with J.J. Watt, who still, in his own right, when healthy, is one of the best defensive linemen in the National Football League. So huge, huge signing right there, J.J. Watt. And, you know, you're getting one of the just great NFL players on and off the field here as well. So let's go on with some other dudes. Marcus Golden, another interesting signing. 2 years, $5 million. I love this signing. I think Marcus Golden is a underrated edge player. I think he's a very solid dude. Like, he's not going to get tons of credit for some of the stuff he does, but I think he's going to be a really good situational pass rusher here. The dude can rack up pressure, and he out there, he's making plays. I love Marcus Golden as just for the value there, 2.5 as a situational pass rusher. Great, great deal. Kelvin Beachum, also another very solid deal here. 2 years, $4 million, 2.1 guaranteed. So again, I mean, he's one of these guys out here. You need players like this. He's going to, if nothing else, be a depth piece, but I think he's probably going to continue to start over at right tackle. Josh Jones might be the future still at that position. Marcus Gilbert coming back also from opt-out, but I love that signing. AJ Green, it's a little bit expensive, but I really believe AJ Green can be a good signing as well. I think he'll play better than he did last year, and I don't know, I just have a feeling about it. I'm going with my gut on AJ Green. I think he can still be a very serviceable receiver and someone who can really help out this offense. Well, speaking of the offense, let's go ahead and dive into the roster breakdown now and kind of take a look at this roster and see where we need to get better at. So we'll still go ahead and start off with the quarterback position. We know where we're at here with Kyler Murray. He is one of the top, I'm almost willing to say he's even close to top five quarterback at this point. I think if you're talking about dual threat quarterbacks, he's top five for sure. Maybe even one of the best dual threat quarterbacks in the league right now. I put him above Lamar Jackson because of his throwing ability. I think he's a better thrower than Lamar Jackson. So you combine it with his good rushing ability that he has and the playmaking ability that he has. He's up there, obviously, with the best quarterbacks in the league. So I'm really big fan of Kyler Murray, and I think he is just getting going in his career. He was so close to 4,000 yards too this year, obviously, if they weren't for the injuries, but he would have gotten there for sure. Other than that though, you know, you're banking on hopefully he can stay healthy. Got to keep him healthy there. Chase Edmonds at running back. We'll go on to the running back situation, which is a little bare right now. It is a little bare, but I'm very optimistic. I love Chase Edmonds a lot. I'm a big fan of him. So I'm hoping that they don't do anything crazy in the draft or nothing like that, because I want to go out and get him in fantasy, especially with some new acquisitions such as Rodney Hudson, which we'll talk about in a second. But I'm super stoked for Chase Edmonds. I think he can be the lead back here. And hopefully they put their faith. Hopefully Cliff Kingsbury puts his faith in him, because I think he can be that lead back. So Eno Benjamin, you're back up here right now. I think we do need to add a piece, though. Like, we need to add a power element, maybe, or something like that. So we'll look to address it at some point. I think it's a later pick, though. I hope they don't go with it in the second round. I think they might, but hopefully they don't. Well, they may not. I don't know, but I'm not a mind reader or nothing. But I'm going to say that they look to address it at some point, whether it's free agency. I've heard some rumors on things they could be looking at, but nonetheless, I'd rather them go, like, you know, seventh round, fifth, seventh round, or even UDFA. But I like Chase Edmonds a lot. On to the receiving core. It all starts with DeAndre Hopkins. I mean, he's a beast, one of the best receivers in the league. So you're in here. At least you have a great weapon with DeAndre Hopkins. He is definitely a top five, if not top three, receiver in the National Football League. D-Hop. Anyway, on the other side, you got AJ Green here. And as I was saying, I think AJ Green can be a really, really good piece along this offense too. I think what he can bring here is going to be someone who is that reliable number two option, and it allows Christian Kirk to be in that slot and demand that slot, which I think he'll be in a much better situation if you keep him in that slot role. So I'm very, very optimistic about this receiving core. If they can stay healthy, I think it's a really good group. So someone, AJ Green, I think could be a very, very productive receiver, 800 to 900 yard receiver. And that is something that they absolutely need here as that second target for Kyler Murray. Other than that, though, Larry Legend, we'll see if he comes back. I put him, you know, in that spot. We'll see if he wants to come back. You also got Keyshawn Johnson as well, who, you know, played a bit in the slot and out wide. He kind of was 50-50 there. Same with Kirk. But, you know, Keyshawn Johnson, one of these guys who maybe, you know, he can continue to step. I think he showed some promise too. So I'm very optimistic about Keyshawn Johnson long term as well, as could be another rotational piece. Andy Isabella, another, you know, slot rotational piece as well. And he is someone, you know, again, you add some more depth on this roster. I like the receiving core. I think it's a good group. I mean, I'm happy with what they've done. You have Max Williams at tight end. That's where we need to look at improving. You got Ian Bunting. What is he from? California. I think he's a California. He's going into his second season now. So I don't think he even played a snap last year. I'm not sure exactly. I don't think he did. But, yeah, I didn't see him. Nonetheless, the tight end group is a little bit iffy. So that's something we have to look at. We got to get better at tight end, because Max Williams, in my opinion, is more of, I mean, he's a solid dude. Like, he can add something in the receiving ability, but he's not going to scare you. He's not really, you know, a mismatch guy. I think they need more of that, you know, that mismatch speed guy in this offense. So we're going to be looking to address that F tight end sort of dude, that role here in this offense. I think that's kind of what they'll be looking at. Onto the offensive line, it starts with DJ Humphreys, who is he had a heck of a season, obviously, but very, very good left tackle. He did a great job in, I mean, pass pro, run blocking, just great tackle. Okay, definitely he was a top five tackle last year, and I think he's definitely one of these top 15 tackles in the league. Great, great tackle for them, and they need him to protect Kyler Murray in the blind side. On the opposite side, we were talking about Kelvin Beachman. I think he's going to be someone, again, as I was saying, just a really solid tackle. You put him out there. You know, he's not going to, like, push, you know, he's not like this great run blocker or nothing. He's not going to push the line or anything like that. But he's a solid pass protector, solid offensive lineman. Hopefully Josh Jones can kind of develop and whatnot. Maybe he's the long-term answer. I'm hoping that he can kind of be that, you know, that role and whatnot. You also got Marcus Gilbert. So, you know, we'll see how he comes back from opt-out. The year off, you know, can make things a little bit interesting. But he's another guy as a rotation. I love what they've done, too, in terms of their depth on this offensive line. So, you know, Max Garcia, they re-signed on a one-year, like, $2 million deal. You also got Brian Winters on a cheap one-year deal as well. Mason Cole could be a cap casualty, so watch out for that. Ronnie Hudson, obviously a trade they got for a third-round pick, and then they swapped, or they got like a seventh back from the Raiders for that. But Justin Pugh, solid left guard here. You know, nothing really else to say. And then Justin Murray, at right guard. I think he had a bit of a rough year, but I think he'll be back. So I mean, it wasn't even that bad. I just think that Mason Cole, I think it was not good, and it was not a good situation there. So I'm actually optimistic about what they're going to do at guard as well. So I think that they're in a good position, offensive line. I mean, it's not the best offensive line in the league, but I think it's going to be a very serviceable offensive line. And adding Rodney Hudson, I think, is going to be huge. So I think this is definitely a top 15 offensive line, barring injuries. I think that between the depth they have and the players they have, I'm really excited for this run game and pass protection for this offense. So let's go on to the defense now. And we'll start here with the secondary, which there's definitely something to be desired here in the secondary. You got Buda Baker, who is one of the premier safeties and just an absolute baller, human missile. This dude's fun to watch, man. So, I mean, I guess you can say that about a lot of players, but Buda Baker is fun to watch, man. He is crazy out there, plays reckless, and I don't know. But nonetheless, Buda Baker, very, very good safety. You can line him up anywhere across this. I mean, you can put him at slot. You can put him at free safety. He plays a lot of free safety. split. You can put him on split. He does so many things well. You can put him in the box sometimes. So, yeah, I mean, they put him in a box actually quite a bit. It's strong. So there's a lot of ways you can use Buda Baker, but very, very good safety there. On the other side, you got Jalen Thompson, who I'm very optimistic about Jalen Thompson. I think that, you know, what he did show in the limited times he has played, he's looked good, and I think that he can be someone you can, you know, definitely pencil in as a strong safety for right now. And, you know, I think he can play split too for sure. In terms of single high, I think that's still something to be questioned. Just not enough snaps to see him on single high to make that determination. But if you're rolling with him, I'm okay with it. I think that it's not the biggest need for him. I think he can be a serviceable starter. So I'm hoping at least. And then you also got Deontay Thompson, obviously Alabama kid. What is he going into his third year now? So he's another one that I think is a solid starter and, you know, a rotational piece and whatnot. So I like their secondary in terms of their starters. You just need some depth because this is like all they have right now. I mean, this is little. I think they have three safeties on the roster, maybe a fourth. I don't think so, but I think they have like three safeties on the roster. So it's a problem. It's something we'll have to look at in the draft. So let's move on to the corners now. And it starts with Byron Murphy's really their number one corner, and he's more of a slot corner. He can play out wide and whatnot, but I'd rather keep him in the slot. I think that's his strength and whatnot. But very, very good slot corner, and I think he can develop into one of the best slot corners in the league. Other than that, though, like it's very tricky. Like, you know, to say the situation least, like it's not great. You got Chase Whittaker. You got Robert Alford, who hasn't played in 2 years. I mean, I like Robert Alford, but he hasn't played in 2 years, and there's going to be rust. I don't care who you are. If you're Jalen Ramsey, if you take 2 years off, there's going to be rust. So I'm not, like, super confident about that situation, you know what I mean? Like, it's just not the greatest situation there. You also got Kevin Peterson on this roster, too. So it's but that's literally about it. Like, that is literally, like, their roster. So, you know, some of these guys may not even be on the roster. So that's why I'm worried about the cornerback position. It is the biggest need on this roster, 100%. I'm hoping they go out and sign someone, right? You got to go out and sign somebody. They can free up some space for sure and, you know, get some sort of corner in here to at least put on the outside. And, you know, obviously we're going to be looking at it in the draft. No matter what, this is going to be a draft need unless something crazy happens. But it's going to be a draft need for them. On to the inside of this defense, and we'll start out with linebacker Isaiah Simmons. Obviously had a bit of a rough start to his career, but, you know, he's a rookie and whatnot. So it was like, you know, you got to get through some learning curves. He played a lot better as the season progressed. He made some big time plays too, made some really big interceptions, some key plays, key tackles. So I'm very, very optimistic for Isaiah Simmons. I think he's going to be a baller, dude. You can use him in so many variety of ways. They were using him in the slot. They were using him, you know, at linebacker, obviously, even at safety. There's just so many ways you can line him up, and he is going to be this versatile piece on the defense. Ooh, it's windy out there, man. I was hearing these gusts going crazy. It's like, what's going on out there? Anyway, going back here to the linebacking core, you got Jordan Hicks as well, who's a really good coverage linebacker, really solid linebacker. I think it's a good group. You know, maybe not the greatest run defending group right there, but I like it. I like what they have. It's kind of, you know, fits your modern mold of the NFL and all that good jazz. So, and plus you combine with what they have on the interior of the defensive line, and we'll talk about that here in a second, but I like their group. Problem is, I think the depth needs to get better. You got Tanner Vallejo, and also Evan Weaver, who hasn't played a snap yet. What was he? He's another California kid, I believe. They drafted sixth round last year, something like that. But they got him later in the draft, maybe fifth or sixth, somewhere around there. But I don't think he hasn't played a snap yet. You got Vallejo, as I was saying, is more of this kind of run defender sort of dude. But, you know, again, we could look to build up some depth at linebacker. Definitely something you could target there. I do think it is a need in a situation, but I like what they have as a starting lineup. I think Simmons and Hicks gives you a very, very good group. And you combine it with their linebacking core that they have, the depth they have there, it's really solid. So, and you know, in terms of the outside linebackers, which we'll go ahead and go on to now. And it starts with Marcus Golden, that pickup, obviously we're talking about. I love that pickup. And then we also, Devin Kennard, they just have him on the interior like that. I just put him over on the outside there, at left outside linebacker too. But, you know, it depends on, you know, which type of role they're going to play him and, you know, what down and all that stuff. So this is more of a nickel defense and you know, what they can do with, you know, like a rush package. But taking a look at their linebackers, Marcus Golden, as I was saying, I think is going to be a very, very good piece for them as a rotational, even a starter. as an edge rusher. He is going to be a monster for him. So happy about that. You got Devin Kennard, who's a decent edge rusher in his own right. Chandler Jones coming back from injury, which we didn't even mention him. Like, Chandler Jones, man, he's a beast within his own right. Hopefully he can get back and be healthy. So you got that there. Dennis Gardeck, another dude to keep an eye out on. Very, very solid in a limited role. Really, really interested to see if he can take that, you know, that next leap in his fourth year. Hopefully, you know, I'm going to be watching him for sure. But I love what they have, man. Just such a dynamic group here, you know, of starters. I mean, like I said, they don't have like that stud maybe edge rusher, even though J.J. Watt, I mean, that's more of interior what I'm talking about. But J.J. Watt's a beast, but I'm talking about edge-wise, you know, whatnot, on the outside. But great guys. I just think it's a great rotation what you have. So I love what they did there. On the interior, it's going to be a question, as I was saying, you know, what they want to do early downs. You got Rashad Lawrence, who can be that kind of that nose tackle. Same with Levi Fucci. So they can kind of rotate there. Jordan Phillips, too, is another big dude out there. Can kind of, you know, good run defender all around. And decent, you know, getting after the passer as well. Zach Allen, I'd like to see him get a little bit better for sure. Hopefully, I'm hoping he can kind of step up and, you know, get kind of to that role, you know, whatnot that we were kind of looking for with him. And that, J.J. Watt, we know J.J. Watt. So you're taking a look at this defense. As I was saying, safety group, we need some depth. Linebacker, maybe need a little bit of depth there. Corner is the big need. Big, big need. And speaking of team needs, let's go ahead and get into those team needs. And first off, we can talk about cap space. They have $1.3 million currently available, which they can make some space, as I was talking about. They might cut Mason Cole. We'll have to wait and see what they want to do there. But, you know, that could save like $2 million. You know, again, every nickel and dime, you got to, you know, figure things out, and they can go out and sign a corner or maybe a running back too, or figure something out there. But running back depth is a need here. Tight end, as I was saying, kind of that F tight end. I really want them to get kind of that playmaking tight end, that speed threat, you know, help out over the middle of the field. I think that would be really helpful there as well. Corner, though, is the biggest need. I think on this roster, corner is the biggest need. It wouldn't even be surprising to me if they do nothing. What I would do is I would double dip on their cornerback situation. Like, it's that big of a need, in my opinion. I would go round one and two corner, but I suspect they'll go out and pick up a corner in free agency. So that's why I'm not going to like double dip in the draft, because I think that they have a plan in place. Okay. I know they'll figure something out there. So free agency is not done. And I also want to, you know, make sure we account for that situation. Safety / linebacker depth, as I was saying, just kind of an area to look out for. But it's a pretty good roster, and I got to say, I think that they've done a good job, and they're definitely going to be trying to compete this year. This is a 10-win team, barring major injuries. I think it's a very, very good roster. So here's their draft picks, and we'll go ahead and get right into this draft here very, very soon. But first off, I just want to kind of, you know, we like to have some fun with these. I just want to point out some of their records and stuff, like some you know, some history about the team, because, you know, it's always fun to kind of learn up on some history sometimes. I'm not a huge history buff, but, you know, I enjoyed history. You know, I had some good teachers in history. But anyway, here's your record. It's one of the, I believe this is the longest franchise in history. I think it's the longest franchise. But anyway, not quite a winning record there, but it's okay. Bruce Arians, their most winningest coach, with a 49-31-1 record there. They've made 10 playoff appearances, and most of them have come in two. So like the 47, 48, you got 74, 75, and 2008, 2009, 14, and 15. So other than, you know, the 82 and the 98 year, they haven't really been able to put together long-term success, but they put it together in two. So hopefully they can make the playoffs this year, and that means they're making the playoffs next year more than likely. But anyway, without further ado, let's go ahead and get into the draft time. But you know how it works. We have to go over a commissioner for the day, and this is an easy one. I mean, you already know who it's going to be. I mean, you can take a guess, but it's Larry Legend, Larry Fitzgerald. He's going to be calling the picks. I love Larry Fitzgerald, and he's just such a great player, man, on and off the field. So we got to give Larry Fitzgerald some love, obviously, because he's just a monster out there. So Larry Fitzgerald going to be calling the picks today and helping us out. And with the first pick in the Arizona Cardinals draft, at pick number 16, we are going with J.C. Horn, that man, the physical dude. He's going to be, you know, that Patrick Peterson replacement here, and we can put him on the outside day one, and I feel confident. You know, obviously, you talk about his, you know, his skill set and what, you know, he needs to get better at, such as, you know, is he the greatest tackler day one? No. There were definitely times on film where it's, you know, a little bit situation. Maybe it's because of a bit of tightness in his hips. He's not the most smooth corner out there, and I do think, to me, he's going to have, like, that Marshawn Lattimore type of, he's kind of like that dude, in my opinion. He's going to have like these games where he just shuts down dudes. And then there'll be games where you see him, and I think he's going to struggle versus more twitchy corners and things like, or sorry, twitchy receivers. Such as, you know, he struggled versus Elijah Moore versus Ole Miss, you know. So that's kind of one example. But I think J.C. Horn here at pick 16, great value. He might even be gone at this point. I think personally Patrick Surtain is the number one corner still, and I would take him number one. I think he solidified that too with his 40 and his movement skills too in his pro day. Looked very, very solid. But J.C. Horn in his own right, I think he should be the second corner off the board, if not the first. But I'm saying second corner. So J.C. Horn going to be the pick here at 16 for the Arizona Cardinals. Let's go on to round number two, and we are going to be taking Brevin Jordan. As I was saying, we need that kind of that F-type receiver, that mismatch that on the outside can kind of be that, you know, that speed threat here, and that's Brevin Jordan. So I'm not, like, super high on his route running. He's not going to be, like, that route runner guy or anything like that. Like, but if you put him in a role and scheme him up and put him on those crossers and put him on those drags and, you know, even put him on screens, dude. Like, he was insane at Florida with, you know, or Miami, sorry, with the screen games. So he's one of these guys. He's going to be a yak dude. You see 9.3 yards that he averaged after contact or after the catch. And yeah, he's going to be a yak monster. Give Kyler Murray that dude over the middle to just make plays. Because you got Hop and you got Green as your chain movers and your cat, you know, those guys on the outside. You need that guy. And I think Brevin Jordan would be a great fit here in this offense. So Brevin Jordan, what I will say here, I would like them to trade down because of, you know, they don't have a third or a fourth round draft selection. So I would prefer if they traded down back into like the, maybe like the top of the third. You might be able to swing Brevin Jordan in the top of the third. You never know. Okay. Or you could look somewhere else, you know, but this is just my option and kind of what I'm thinking, you know, keep an open mind. We're not doing trades with these because it's just not fair, I don't think, but we will be talking about situations and outcomes that they could be looking at. So that is something that you could definitely keep an eye out on for a potential trade there to get some more draft capital. On to our fifth round selection here at 160. It's Bryce Tompkins. And this is a guy who I think will be someone you can also, I think he can be a day one starter. Like, I think he's that decent. I think he's a good corner. So he's not the most athletically gifted guy or nothing, but he has great ball skills. As I was saying, interception machine. He had 8 in 3 years. You know, he's just a really solid corner. I think he's going to be a guy who can play the outside. He's physical enough and he can get it done. So I'm very, very excited to see where Bryce Tompkins goes. And I think he'd be an absolute steal in the fifth round here. So big, big pickup to improve your secondary. I'm double dipping a corner. No matter what they do, I'm taking some corners to help improve this, you know, this depth on the cornerback roster group. So yeah, that's what we're doing. Next pick here into the round seven, which they have 2 7th round picks at 243, though, we are going to be taking Sean Davis, the safety from Florida. This guy is one of those dudes I think can fit this team very, very well. Has experience playing a lot of different roles, whether it's split, single, high, can do both, and, you know, can play in the box even. So, you know, whether or not how they like to use their safeties, they like to move around and whatnot, I think that he can fit this sort of defense and what they're like to do. So really think he's going to be an interesting name to keep an eye out on. And when you're looking at seventh round guys, you're just looking at guys who can be development guys and hopefully be roster positions for you. So I think that he can definitely do that here. Let's go on to our last pick at number, you know, 247 here. It's going to be that power element. That's Trey Regis. He is going to be that dude here. Big, strong runner, tough guy. And, you know, put up some good film versus Alabama. So I think he's a guy that, you know, again, you know, you're taking later in the draft and it'd be a good complement to Eno and Chase Edmonds. So that is kind of what I'm seeing here with this draft. And, you know, you have to let me know, but let's go ahead and talk about where they fit now into the roster. So, you know, it starts with, you know, we can look at Brevin Jordan now coming in as that tight end, that F tight end, and being that playmaker tight end, get him the ball in space, just let him eat up, get him yak and all that good jazz. I think he can be a good weapon there for Kyler Murray. And now you got yourself a good, decent pairing with Max Williams. Can be that inline guy. Brevin Jordan there. Boom. There you go. Got some, you know, some weapons there. You know, not to mention, you know, your outside guys with Hop, Green, and then Kirk in the slot. So, boom. There you go. Anyway, at running back, you now add Trey Regis as that power element there onto this rotational group at running back. You can go from there. But hopefully Chase Edmonds is the feature back. So that's your offense there. That's really, you know, all the changes. Let's go on. And we also have the rookie. So everyone in green is a rookie here. Let's go on to the defense and what we've added on defense. So it all starts with what we've done with JC Horn, huge addition. He's going to come in and be that starting outside corner. I think Bryce Tompkins, you know, might be able to compete for that starting role day one, but Robert Alford is a good starter as well day one, and hopefully he'll be ready to go. It's going to be an interesting situation, but we get pieces there at corner. We add a couple guys, and then, you know, at secondary, we add Sean Davis as well to that secondary, adding depth at that safety group, which I think we desperately need. Injuries happen, you know, things of that nature. So that is the changes to the roster, and that is going to be, I think we filled in at least the holes for the roster and whatnot. I mean, I don't think there's tons of holes. I think corner is the biggest hole for sure. Other than that, it's building some depth on the roster. But that is going to be the roster breakdown and mock draft for the Arizona Cardinals. So, you know, like I said, let me know what you think. If there's any suggestions on how you think I can make these better. I'm always trying to improve these roster breakdowns. I want to make them the best out there if possible. But I hope you did enjoy them. And Arizona Cardinal fans, you know, I'm happy for your future. I think that this is going to be a very, very good team, and we'll see what they do in the draft. But that is going to be it for this one. I hope everybody has a really, really good day. My name is GSLING. I'm doing my thing, and I hope you do too and everything. So I hope you have a great day, and I'll talk to you really, really soon. Bye.